Okay, today we're going to be talking about complex numbers, which are imaginary numbers. They have imaginary parts to them. So with our first definition. The first definition we have is we're going to define the square root of negative 1. Let me change to blue pen. Square root of negative 1. We're going to define that as I. Up to this point, whenever we had a square root of a negative, we haven't been able to give an answer. And part of that same definition is that I squared, this should be squared here, I squared equals negative 1. So that's two parts of a definition that you just need to memorize. So these are called imaginary numbers. They'll be used on and off throughout the semester. I'll tell you when we can use it and when we can't. Basically, when we're solving equations, we can have imaginaries. But we get into graphing and functions, we want to avoid imaginaries. Those are only reals. Complex numbers are defined to be when you take real parts and imaginary parts and combine them together. So like 2 plus 3i. 2 plus 3i is one complex number. It has its real part, 2, and its imaginary part, 3i. And you're always going to want to leave your answers in this form with the real part first and then the imaginary part and the I at the end. That's considered to be standard form. And if you're in MathXL, they will require that and they won't accept. For instance, if you had 3i plus 2 as an answer, they would mark it wrong because it's not in standard form. The 2 has to come first. Moving on, let's look at some definitions. First of all, whenever you have a square root, so we defined what a square root of a negative 1 was, but this is defining all other square roots of negative numbers. It's saying if you have a square root of a negative number, you bring an I out in front, basically you're factoring out an I, and it's the square root of, so in other words, the square root of negative 3 is equal to I times the square root of positive 3. So the 3 becomes positive. Okay, and right here you must use this definition before you use any other rules for radicals. So for this problem that's coming up with the square roots of negative 7, you need to, your first step, if you have a square root of a negative 7, make that an I times the square root of 7. And the other one also, make it I times the square root of 7. So you bring the I's out in front, the 7's become positive, and then you just use your other rules. So we have four things being multiplied. So we can multiply the two I's together and get I squared. I squared, my little pointer thing. I'm going to pause this. Okay. So I've got a different pointer. We'll see if it works better. So we multiply our i's together and we get I squared. We multiply our two square roots of 7 together and get square root of 49, which is just 7. So we have 7i squared. Now we can't leave that there because if you think back to our definitions on the two pages before, we know what I squared is. I squared is defined to be negative 1. So I squared is negative 1. So our final answer is negative 7. For this next one, same thing. Square root of negative 6 becomes I square root of 6. Square root of negative 10 becomes I square root of 10. You multiply your I's together and get I squared. You multiply your 6 and your 10 together to get square root of 60. So what are we going to have? We're going to have a negative 1 outside. And also, if you do a factor tree for 60, you'll see that it factors into 20 times 3. And 20 is 4 times 5. And 4 is 2 times 2. There's a set of two 2's. So a 2 comes out in front of the radical. And what's left under? 3 times 5, so 15. And we also have that negative 1 there. So we're going to have a negative 2 out front, square root of 15. So let's talk about this. The negative is there because of the I squared. The 2 is there because 60 factored into 2 2's, so that 2 came out, and then the 15 is there because 60 factored into 2 2's plus a 3 and a 5, and the 3 and the 5 multiplied give you 15. Okay. If we look at the powers of I, and these should all be powers, this didn't come out right, those should be exponents, not coefficients. I was defined to be the square root of negative 1. I squared was defined to be negative 1. What's I cubed then? Well, if you can think of I cubed, just because of how exponents work, I cubed is I squared times I, right? That's what I cubed means. I squared is negative 1. Well, actually, let's go back. Dang. Okay, we don't want to put negative 1 there. We want to put I. I to the first is I. I squared is negative 1. I to the third is negative I. I to the fourth can be defined to be I squared times I squared, because that's what fourth power means. Each of those I squareds is negative 1. So I to the fourth is defined to be positive 1, because it's negative 1 times negative 1. So I to the first is I. I squared is negative 1. I to the third is negative I. I to the fourth is 1. I to the fifth is I to the fourth times I. I to the fourth, we just decided a second ago, was 1. So this is 1 times I, or just I. I to the sixth can be defined to be what? I to the fifth times I. And I to the fifth, we just decided, was I. So this is I times I. I squared, which is, we know from over here, I squared is negative 1. And after you do these for a little while, breaking down the I to the 7th, you could write that as I to the 6th times I, and then multiplying it out, you'll find out that the powers of I are actually cyclical. They go from, I, negative 1, negative I, 1, I, negative 1, negative I, 1, I, negative 1, negative I, 1. Etc. forever. So if we want to see I to the 19th, you just got to figure out what row we would be in. Are we in the first row, second row, third row? Well, I to the 19th doesn't mean much to me, but I to the 20th. I to the 20th means something to me, because if you look at this row, those exponents are all divisible by 4, right? So I to the 20th would be divisible by 4. So I to the 20th would be on this row. So I to the 19th must be on this row. So I to the 19th must be minus I. I to the 29th. So figure out what row that's in. Well, I to the 28th, 28 is divisible by 4. So 28 would be in this row. So 29 would be on the next row, which would be the top row. So it would be I. So you can figure those out. Moving on. Writing a complex number in standard form, A plus BI. So we've got this complex number. The first thing I notice is that I have a negative number under the radical. So I'm going to make this 15 minus I square root of 75 over 5. So bring that I out, and 75 becomes positive. Then do factor tree to simplify square root of 75, and we see that, okay, sorry about that. 15 minus a 5 comes out, I square root of 3. Over 5. So what do we do next? Well, I can tell it's factors. I mean, I can tell it's going to reduce. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use a property of fractions, and this will be very helpful to learn later on. If I have two terms in the top like that, I can split this up into two separate fractions. This is 15 over 5 minus 5i times the square root of 3 over 5. So split them into two separate fractions, both over 5, and then each of those fractions reduces. The 15 over 5 reduces to 3 over 1, or just 3. The 5i squared of 3 over 5, the 5's cancel, and I just get I squared of 3, and you're done. Okay, this one, we are adding and subtracting complex numbers, and we add and subtract them by just adding and subtracting like terms. So I add all my real parts together. First of all, I'm going to write it without parentheses. Minus 9 plus 7i plus 3 minus 15i minus 3 plus 9i. And now I'm going to add all my real parts together. Negative 9 plus 3 minus 3 is going to be negative 9. So my real part of my answer is going to be negative 9. My imaginary is 7i minus 15i. So that gives me negative 8i plus 9i. So I'm going to have plus I. And that's your final answer. Notice I've left it in standard form, my real part, and then my imaginary. We're almost done. Multiplying complex numbers. So complex numbers have two terms, so we're just going to FOIL them. And just keep in mind that I squared is negative 1. So for this particular problem, 2 times 3 is my first. My outers are 2 times 4i, so 8i. My inners are negative 3i. Times positive 3, so negative 9i. That was supposed to be an I, wasn't it? My lasts are negative 3i and positive 4i, so negative 12i squared. So we FOIL. Notice a couple things. First of all, these are going to be like terms, so I can add those together. Oops, I made another mistake. That's I squared. So So notice that we have an I squared is what I was going to say. An I squared is negative 1. So what do we have? We have a 6 minus I, because we've added those two like terms, minus 12 times negative 1. So whenever you get an I squared, replace it with negative 1 immediately. So I have 6 minus I plus 12. And now the 6 and the 12 are like terms, and I can add. So I have 18 minus I for my final answer. So that's how you multiply complex numbers. Lastly, dividing complex numbers. And you need to think about the fact that I represents an imaginary number. An imaginary number. But it also represents square root of negative I. So having an I in a denominator is the same as having a root in the denominator. It's not allowed. So we're going to treat this just like we did when we had two terms with a root in the bottom. And what do? We multiply top and bottom by the conjugate of the bottom. So that's what we're going to do, 5 plus 4i. So in the top, we're going to have to FOIL. So my first will be 15, my outers will be 12i, my inners will be 35i, my last will be 28i squared. In the bottom, we have to FOIL, but keep in mind those are conjugates, so I can actually skip outers and inners. Just do first and last, so 25 minus 16i squared. And now we've got a little cleaning up to do. First of all, these are like terms. I'll combine them. And then I see I squareds in two places. I need to replace those with negative 1. So in the numerator, I'll have 15 plus 47i minus 28. And the denominator, I'll have 25 plus 16 because I've replaced those I squareds with negative 1. So now in the numerator, I have negative 13 plus 47i. And the bottom, I have 41. And you're almost done. The only thing is this is really isn't standard form. You need to separate out your real parts and your imaginary. So in other words, I'm going to split the top up into, I'm going to split this into two separate fractions, plus 47 over 41i. So now I've got my real part and my imaginary like separate as two separate terms. All I did was split this up into two separate fractions. All done.